Good afternoon to you all. Thank you very much for coming to participate in our discussion on the Syrian refugee crisis. As you can see, we have three wonderful panelists here, and they're all going to be giving their own unique perspective of the situation. I want to emphasize that they are not representing an institution or an organization. They are three individuals who are very familiar with the situation both in Syria and in the Middle East, and we're very, very lucky to have them. So we've got Roula. Roula was, she's an LLM survivor. So she graduated last year, has been with us now for a while. We've got Dima, who is in the process of surviving the LLM. And we've got Aysar, who is hoping to join us maybe in January as a researcher. They're all going to be providing their own unique input on the crisis. So again, I want to thank you all very much for coming and agreeing to participate with us. I'd like to ask everybody again to let's respect one another. Let's engage in an honest conversation. We're going to try and leave a lot of time for Q&A because I'm sure everybody has an opinion. Everybody wants to express their views. But again, if you're to do so, please do so in a respectful manner. So again, thank you to our panelists. I also want to say thank you very much to Professor O'Malley for organizing this. It's really her tenacity and her commitment to have this panel right before Thanksgiving that has made this happen. So thank you very much. And without further ado, Roula, why don't you kick us off, please?
Hello, everybody. First of all, I want to thank all of you for being here and for your interest in Syria. My name is Roula, and I am a lawyer from Syria. I graduated last year as an LLM, and I focused my studies on human rights and especially refugees with disabilities. And now I'm working as an employment specialist with Catholic charities, and I'm working on a research paper about the protection of Syrian refugees with disabilities. And that's what I would like to talk about today and share my information with you. I want to start by giving you some statistics, because numbers can really, and statistics can really tell how big the problem that we Syrians have been going through since 2011. Besides, collection data and statistics can, can help the international community to improve the efforts and really help this population that has been neglected. On 2007, the League of Arab States has done a study on disability in the Arab region, and studies showed that in Syria, there was 279,000 persons with disabilities out of almost 21 million population. Recently, studies has showed that that the war has left 1.5 million people with disabilities in Syria. Besides disabilities, the Syrian crisis has generated a very large refugee movement. In 2010, the number of refugees and displaced person and person who are of concern to the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, the UNHCR, was estimated by 36.5 million. In 2015, the UNHCR estimated the number of refugees that fled Syria by more than 4 million, and the number of people has been displaced within Syria, almost 5 million. So the total is 9 million, which is almost half of the population. Within the refugee population, people with disabilities face special challenges and require a lot of attention and support. But the humanitarian programming had showed that this population has been neglected, and there's no data. And unfortunately, the number of Syrian refugees with disabilities are unknown and probably overwhelming. The biggest problem this population face is they are not protected legally. There's no international instrument that can currently that can protect them. They can only be referred to in several provisions of laws and international human laws and treaties. I'm just going to talk very briefly about the convention, the Refugee Convention, and the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, the CRPD. The Refugee Convention only and specifically mention people with disabilities in Article 24 about labor legislation and social security. It only say that all refugees are entitled to the same social security rights, just like the rights of the citizens of the country. So the convention neglected people with disabilities, even through the definition, the refugee definition. According to the convention, the refugee is a person who is outside of his country or her country of origin, cannot go back or unwilling to go back, owing to a well-founded fear of persecution for reasons of race, religion, nationality, political opinion, or membership of a social group. So persons with disabilities have to show their belonging to one of these five enumerated groups. They have struggles and still struggling to prove their well-founded fear to persecution, and especially linking that to the fear of their membership in a particular social group, since the convention has failed to recognize them. Because of that, scholars has been arguing that people with disabilities constitute a particular social group. And the main reason of the convention when they mentioned the particular group is to provide a catch-all for all the groups that are not included in the other four categories, which is religion, nationality, political opinion, and race. But since the United Nations developed the Refugee Convention in 1951, it has remained unchanged. And it neglected the protection of people with disabilities. On the other hand, the CRPD requires state parties to ensure that persons with disabilities are protected in situation of risk and humanitarian crisis, and the international cooperation is essential and accessible for persons with disabilities. So according to the CRPD, state parties are obligated to promote and protect the right of people with disabilities in their territory, including those who have been displaced through the border. But that is much easier to say than done, because, especially in Syria's case, because most of the hosting countries are neighboring countries, and they are developing countries. They don't have the resources, and they face many challenges. And other states are hesitating for many political and other reasons. People with disabilities living in situation of conflict has been recognized by the UNHCR Executive Committee on the conclusion of refugees with disabilities as a vulnerable group. And Syrian refugees with disabilities has been called the hidden victims of the conflict. They are risk invisibility and exclusion from support and services and durable solutions. They are exposed to discrimination, violence, and sexual and gender-based violence. Therefore, there is a greater need to adopt an international instrument that can guide states and international organizations to protect refugees with disabilities from the barriers they face. And thank you.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for being here. Thank you for my colleagues and Professor O'Malley, who made this happen, and for Professor Kfir for mediating the event, and Professor yes. Sorry, I'm a little bit nervous. And thank you all for being here, and for Andrew as well. My name is Dima Hussain. I'm now an LLM student. I am coming from Syria, and I studied law in Syria, and then I studied international law. I worked with UNHCR in protection and GBV. I started working as a caseworker, and then as a senior caseworker, and then as coordinator of the women's shelter, and for a short time as a coordinator of the juvenile two centers in Damascus. Then I moved to Lebanon, and I worked with an Italian NGO called CALSF. We worked on a program to support Syrian civilian activists on their small projects inside Syria, and on providing trainings for them on human rights and other transitional justice and other methods. After that, I worked with the Norwegian Refugee Council as a field coordinator. We worked on a legal program called ICLA. It's an Information Counseling Legal Assistance for Syrian Refugees. So that's why I will speak today about the Syrian refugees' condition in Lebanon. In Lebanon, the number of Syrian refugees are 1.5 million, according to the registration records of UNHCR. And those are the numbers that are registered with UNHCR. But of course, there's other numbers that are not registered because they are unwilling or unable to register. And I will explain why they are unable. In Lebanon, Syrian refugees living in urban setting, and some of them living in random tents, which we called actually informal tented settlements. And those are tents that are built of plastic bags and other plastic materials that is not actually, that they are not waterproof. So what happened like during winter that those tents are flooded and all the belonging of the Syrians actually will be just in mass, and the situation will be very critical during winters. So I will speak basically about the legal problems that the Syrian refugees are facing, because I work on a legal program actually providing information. So the main problem is the limited legal status that the Syrian refugees found themselves in Lebanon. Many of the Syrian refugees are crossing the Lebanese border illegally, and therefore they are obliged to stay in an illegal status in Lebanon because there is no method to legalize their station, their status. Actually, there is something that they call a petition of mercy, but it's not granted in all of the times, and the fees of it is very high. It's like 600 per person. And imagine for a family of 7 persons, so this cost is very high. And it's just granted on, actually the regulation in Lebanon towards refugees are not specific. So it depends on the officer in charge and his mood actually, even to grant this or not. And some of the refugees also are crossing the border without documentation because they were obliged to flee the war or the conflict, and they didn't have time to bring their belongings or their documentations. Another issue is the residency, because the Lebanese government is giving the Syrians a special kind of residency. It's like residency just for Syrians. It's 6 month residency, which is renewable for every 6 months, and the fee also is high. It's like $200 to renew this residency, and that's why many also families found themselves illegal again, because even if they have documentation, even if they cross the border legally, they might be illegal because they couldn't renew the residency because of the fee. And that will put actually the refugees in a critical condition, and there is consequences of this limited legal status of the Syrian refugees. First, they will have continuous risk of deportation and detention, and being sent back to Syria, where they might face detention or risking their life. Also, there is a limited freedom of movement, because in Lebanon there's checkpoints all over the roads, because the security condition in Lebanon is affected by what's going on in Syria. And then their access to services, especially to health, is actually limited because they cannot move freely. Their registration with UNHCR and with other NGOs who provide assistance, financial and other kind of type of assistance, will be also affected. Their access to justice, and that means they will be put in a very vulnerable situation and at risk of being exploited all the time. And their newborn baby cannot be registered, and this is a big problem actually for Syrian refugees in Lebanon, And that means we are waiting, or we will see a whole generation of Syrians in Lebanon who are unregistered and who are like at risk of being stateless. And all of this situation actually puts Syrian refugees in a very vulnerable place, targeted to be exploited and trafficked at all times, at all means. There's other kind of problems that Syrian refugees are facing, which is economic problems. Of course, no freedom to movement, no work permit, and limited financial help. That means like hardship and poverty. And of course, there is no formal camps. The Lebanese government did not allow formal camps to be established in Lebanon because they feared, this is what they say actually, they feared that the condition of the Palestinian camps to be repeated again. And many family has lost their breadwinner, so they don't have any type of like gaining their livings every day. Some families came with their savings, but with the prolonging of the situation, of the Syrian situation, that means that those savings are fading away, and that means more families are facing like poverty and hardship. The other types of problem is the racism by the host community that the Syrians are facing, because of the, or due to the political history between Syria and Lebanon, Syrians are facing racism by the Lebanese, and we have witnessed curfews in several areas in Lebanon, like in Bekaa, for example, where it's targeted just or applied just on the Syrian refugees and restricting their freedom of movement at night. And there have many incidents of beating of Syrians in the street just because of they are Syrians. Few incidents of kidnapping and asking for ransom of the Syrian refugees. There is also problems that are faced by women. Women are facing forced marriage and early marriage because of the related to the poverty, of course, and they are facing rape and sexual exploitation and forced prostitution. There's problems that are faced by the children because, like in Lebanon, the schools are, they are applying segregation in the shifts of schools between Syrian and Lebanese. There is no mixed schools, and the opportunities to have formal education is very limited. Even at schools, Syrians are facing, Syrian children are facing racism, beating sometimes from the schoolmates or from the teachers. And they are dropping out of school because of work, and they are suffering from psychological conditions and isolation and sexual exploitations. The causation of all of this actually can be, do I speak about causation now or okay? So the causation, I can actually classify it in two reasons, which is the government approach that towards the Syrian crisis and the UNHCR and other humanitarian NGOs approach. So the government approach actually, as we mentioned, not adopting clear regulations and like having a refugee law to apply to in the case of the Syrian refugees, the high fees of renewing the legal status or legalizing your stay in Lebanon, not adopting clear procedure, as we mentioned, regarding the legalization, and not allowing establishment of the formal camps, not recognizing the UNHCR the registration paper as a formal document that proved the identity and the stay, and the legal stay of the Syrian refugees. So those are the causation from the government side, from the UNHCR side actually, and other humanitarian actors. UNHCR in general, is their approach is like providing immediate humanitarian assistance, and is a little bit weak when it comes to short to long term and prolonged crisis. That's why the situation of the refugees actually worsening within time, because it's not easy for them to handle those kind of crises, and crises that are also massive. Another thing is that the approach in Lebanon is a cluster up. What we call it is a cluster approach. That means that humanitarian organizations are classified according to what they are doing. So there is a clear classification, like providing food, health, shelter, and other type of assistance. And each NGO is clustered within those categories. And this cluster approach is coordinating, actually usually it's coordinated by OCHA, but in the case of Lebanon, it's coordinated by UNHCR. And here's the problem, because UNHCR here is playing two roles. They are the donor for many of the other NGOs, and they are now the coordinator. And that means that damage actually the transparency when reporting to the coordinator, because it's your donor as well. So you cannot actually express all of your concerns and worries and even like failures. Also, there is one thing that which is very important actually, that is UNHCR is lacking strong advocacy methods towards government or hosting governments that they are working under. For example, in Lebanon, the advocacy towards like establishing formal camps has started with the start of the Syrian crisis in 2011, but have achieved zero development on the ground. And actually what's happening is that they stopped even this advocacy on this side. So that's it from my side. I will turn over to my colleague, and thank you very much.
So ladies and gentlemen, my name is Aysar. I'm here visiting one of the schools in California and doing a research regarding a refugee camp in Damascus. We have like Syrians and Palestinian refugees who are trapped, and the UN agency have failed in delivering food and assistance. I am Palestinian Jordanian and I work for UNHCR Jordan. And I'm gonna brief you about some information regarding the operation in Amman. But unfortunately, we won't have much time to talk about it, so I'm gonna put some points, talking briefly about it, and then you will ask me questions, and for sure, and Dima and Roula, and we can throw into details with these topics. So I'm gonna first mention the food in Syria. So this is really interesting. Let's imagine, I'm not so good in drawing, but let's say that this is Jordan, and this is Syria. People are approaching the Jordanian government, Jordan Syria government, from Aleppo, Damascus, and Homs. Dima mentioned something really important. We have something we call it regular fleeing. Sorry, bad handwriting. And regular fleeing. So, and here we have the official cross-border between Jordan and Syria. So before the conflict erupted in Syria, Syrians and Jordanians used to move between Jordan and Syria through this point. It's called Nasib. After the conflict, people started fleeing from Aleppo, mainly Damascus, Daraa, and Homs, in addition to some people from Hama, through the fence, like that. After that, the Free Syrian Army, we call it FSA, has established good connection with the government of Jordan. So now they are escorting people to flee through Nasib, but through the fence, not through the official crossing point. Through the fence and through one other point here, in Mafraq. So this is what we call it, a regular fleeing. Regular fleeing means the other type, that people are crossing through the official crossing point in the border, stamp their passport by the Syrian officials. After that, go through the no man's land and cross to Jordan. Unfortunately, the border has been closed for almost 2 years. We have very rare cases that managed to flee and stamp their passport officially by the two governments. So, people who are irregularly fleeing to Jordan need to go from here or here to Zaatar. Okay. So, when people come to Zaatari, the refugee camp and one of the most, or one of the largest camps in the world, they receive this. We call this as a ration card. So this is the ration card. Here we have UNHCR logo. UNHCR stands for United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. And we have here we have the logo of WFP. It's not really clear. So World Food Program. Both UN agencies are partners in providing assistance, food, and protection. So in this card, here we have this code and this number. This number is the number of the applicant, and I'm not going to say that Syrians who are in Zaatari are refugees officially under the international law. They are applicants or asylum seekers. I do prefer to say applicants rather than saying refugees or asylum seekers, because we don't know or they have not gone through the process of evaluating or assessing their persecution claims. So this number is the number for the applicant in our system. So in this number, if we open our system, we call it RICE. If we open RICE, we can see how much he's receiving or she's receiving. Does he or she has, for example, any protection concern? Which kind of organization is providing the assistance to him or to her or to the family? These numbers from 1 to 16, it is the family size. So for example, if me, my two wives, and my three kids fled from Syria to Jordan, it will be a big issue, because the first wife will be registered with me in the same ration card with the kids from her, and the second wife will receive another ration card. So in this card, for example, of course, I'm just hiding the name on the back of the card because it is confidential. The family size is 8. So let's imagine that a man, his wife, 6 children, or a vulnerable woman, the women who are coming without husbands, a vulnerable woman with 7 children, or let's say a mom with her 6 siblings. A woman with her 6 siblings. So the important here is the family size. And these numbers here, from like, we start 1 till 34, are for WFP, World Food Program, in order to receive bread and food assistance. So, sorry, here it is like 34 weeks of receiving food, and after that he or she, the applicant, will receive a new ration card. These people are staying in the camp. So officially, they are restricted to move out or inside the camp. They need to remain inside the camp. They are not allowed to go and work outside the camp. Yes, people do escape from the camp. People do pay money in order to escape from the camp, and people like to work in the urban. So whenever I say in the camp, people are staying inside Zaatari camp, in the urban setting, which means in the community, in the Jordanian community. Okay. Let's say that I'm a Syrian refugee, I'm a Syrian applicant, and I fled from the camp, from Zaatari camp, and I went to the urban setting. I did approach, for example, one of UNHCR offices all over the kingdom, and I need to be registered with UNHCR in order to receive the protection and in order not to be deported by the authorities and forcing to go back to Syria, and we call it reformant. It's a French word, but this is how we call it under international law. So this is the registration card. So it's not really clear, but I'm gonna read the information here in English and in Arabic. So here is the registration at Tasjil. Here we put the name, al-ism, and here we put the date of the interview. So let's say Dima wants to approach me as a UNHCR staff member or as a protection officer, and she wants to be registered with her husband or with his kid, or with her kids or with her mom. So I'm gonna take her full name, Dima. then I'm going to say that the interview will be like on the 19th of November 2015. Here I'm going to say the time of the appointment or the interview is 8 a.m., 9 a.m., 10 a.m. And here I'm going to say the family size. It's really important to mention the family size. Dima and Roula, both of them, they have mentioned something really important regarding documentation. This is how, this is why we take or we focus on family size, because people are fleeing Jordan and, generally speaking, Syrian, sorry, Syrian applicants are fleeing Jordan without documentations. Many reasons. As Dima said, maybe they forgot, maybe they don't have the time, maybe their documents were burnt, torn out, their place was destroyed. But generally speaking, people who are fleeing from Daraa in the south, Daraa is here, near the borders. We call it Sahel Horan, or Horan Hell, or Horan area, or neighborhood, I don't know what you call it in Syria. But people who are fleeing from Horan, generally speaking, they don't believe in documenting their marriage. I don't know why. But the majority of them, they got married, and then they don't go to the court in order to endorse it or have it official. So, for example, I got married last 6 years ago, and I have 5 kids now. And I will ratify or I will recognize my marriage before the court when my first kid wants to be enrolled in the school. So for some people who fled to Jordan, they have 5 kids, 5 small kids, and I have, as a protection officer at UNHCR, I have no proof or no document that show what is the relation between me and my wife and what is the relation between these kids and me. And it's not easy to ask the kids separately. For sometimes the kids are only 2, 3, 4 years, they are not able to talk, and I'm not able to establish what I call it family link. So it's not easy. That's why we are doing this. And for some time, we do register them, but we give them what we call it benefit of the doubt. So he or she has a claim, I have no documents, he has no documents, he or she needs protection, I need to believe him or her, but I put like a big exclamation mark in our language in his or her file in order to establish family link for resettlement in a third country purposes. I was a little bit brief because we don't have time. We can go for some questions to me, Roula and Dima. So, questions?
First of all, thank you very much, Roula. I think what you saw today is sort of three very distinctive opinions as to what exactly is happening in Syria and why this conflict and this crisis is so pertinent to our daily discussions. And I leave it to you to ask questions.
I have a question for, I'm Addy, I'm a public administration student.
He was raising his hand.
Oh,
from,
I'm sorry.
After you.
I'm a public administration student. I'm at Syracuse University, Maxwell School. I have a question for Dima on the power sharing constitution of the Lebanese government. And I consider that perhaps the nature of the constitution and the government structure has led to the situation where they're unwilling to allow a change in the ethnic makeup or in the community makeup of the nation. And perhaps targeting the constitutional structure of Lebanon might be a key that could unlock some of these seemingly intractable issues.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, I think it's, as you mentioned, it's constitutional worry about the like ethnic percentage in Lebanon, but it's also political as well. But like as a from a humanitarian approach, you cannot just leave 1.5 million people in limbo, like, and while the situation continues and while they have also newborn babies that are not registered simply. So I don't know if like building formal camps for Syrian refugees in Lebanon will actually be in the same situation as the camps of Palestinian, because I don't see that the Syrian crisis will end continue forever. It will like end at some point, and many of those people will go back to their homeland. So I don't agree with the worries of the Lebanese government, and something has to be done to save all of those. Like, there's children that are dying during winter in those horrible situation of the random camps or the informal tented settlement that we call it. So, yeah. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I was wondering if any at all, really, of the people applying for refugee status have any access to legal counsel? Is UNHCR receptive to them having any access to legal counsel in the process?
Thank you.
Like in Lebanon, yes, there is, like for example, in our program, we provided information about the documentation side, but we had also a lawyer that was providing information on other issues like marriage, divorce, and other types of legal issues, yes.
Same in Jordan, same situation in Jordan. We have like an implementing partner, we call them implementing partners. They are funded by UNHCR, and that they are like a law firm that gives you legal counseling and legal help for the courts for free, out of charge.
So UNHCR is receptive?
But there's a certain criteria, of course.
Sorry?
So is UNHCR receptive to them having legal access to legal counseling?
Yeah, we do facilitate that. We do facilitate that.
Does it only have to be through the organization sort of
sanctioned
by
UNHCR? Any Syrian, even if he or she is not registered with UNHCR, so he's not an applicant or she's not an applicant, he or she has the right to approach legal aid, the law firm called legal aid. Out of charge, they will help or help.
But what about other organizations?
Could they receive help from legal help from other organizations besides the ones that UNHCR gives them?
No. UNICEF has funded like law firm, legal aid for a limited amount of money for the vaccination in order to have a campaign for vaccination in 2013, I guess.
Like, is it common for people at all to get any sort of legal assistance?
Yeah, they do. They do.
Like what percentage do you think?
I don't have percentages. Statistics, I don't have.
Yeah, but to receive like a free of charge legal assistance, it's not applicable for everybody. There's certain criteria that each NGO adopts, actually. So, yeah.
I had a quick question. So I'm not a human rights lawyer, and this isn't my area of expertise, but it seems that one of the major problems is simply the idea of camps. Other than as a temporary measure, why are they having people stay in these types of housing longer term? We don't have refugee camps in the United States. If you're granted refugee status, you're bound into housing and become part of the community. So wouldn't it be best to try to normalize everyone's status as quickly as possible in the host institution? And why do we have to have camps at all?
Yeah, of course. That would, I don't know.
You can I answer?
I would like to answer.
Go ahead, start ahead.
Yeah.
I believe that there's, you have to consider this, for example, the size of the country and the situation and the poverty percentage. It's not easy to let these people involve in the, because they are discriminated against, and it's not easy for the community to accept them as a start, and it's not easy for the government to cover, even if they're gonna work, but it's still, I believe it's easier for the governments to keep them on the side. And so at some point they would like love them to leave. I don't have experience with the camps as much as my colleagues, but that's what I believe is. For example, America, and which is one of the good points, is refugee here. Even they're still sometimes like not living perfectly, but it's really nice that they can just live like everybody else. They can just work, and if they are willing to, they can really have a good life. In other countries, neighboring countries of Syria, because of the political situations and all the social community, it's not easy just to accept them. I'm just talking from a humanitarian aspect, my own perspective of the subject, so I don't know what you have to say.
Actually, yeah, as Roula mentioned, because of the neighboring country that refugees are fleeing to, usually, they are also poor. And they, like for example, in Lebanon, they are not signatory to the 1951 convention, and they don't adopt refugee law that provide them with the rights. So, like camps is the, of course, the perfect situation is what you mentioned actually is to like just try to integrate them to the community. But there is resistance from the government to do this, And like the second better option is to have the formal camps, because then you will be provided with the housing and you don't need to like be exploited actually at work or other type of exploitation to pay for your rent. So yeah, this is basically it.
It seems to me like we can lobby those governments towards integration. That seems like everyone can get behind that.
Yeah, exactly.
I was wondering, I don't remember if it was Dima or Roula that brought this up, but about the people who become with no legal status once they've legally entered the country. I'm just wondering what access to services and help do they have? So once they're there legally, so or illegally, I guess it really doesn't matter for this question, how do they get the help that they need when they have no legal status?
Okay. Yeah, because I mentioned the illegal status of the refugees. Yeah, actually, the access of services will be very limited. And in most situations, we were witnessed that women will be sent to collect assistance, for example, because sometimes government will be more tolerant towards women than men. But that, again, will put women at risk because they might be detained and exploited or harassed through the checkpoints or in jail. So actually, families try to adopt survival mechanism around this. Sometimes children are sent. But it's damaged, of course, their rights to collect assistance.
Yes. My question is not going to focus on Syria refugee. My question is going to tell you something about President Assad in Syria. As you know, Russia says Syria with Mr. Assad, and NATO countries are saying Syria without Assad. Tell us several reasons why people in Syria are displaced. Where is the problem? I am going to tell you I have a problem with my eyes. You are going to operation my head. Can you or could you tell us some several reasons why people are displaced, why people are going to leave Syria? Where is the problem? Russia is responsible, NATO countries are responsible, or Mr. Assad is responsible?
Okay, you're asking one of us or all of us? Okay.
So maybe I'll take this one. I think really kind of one of the things that we are trying to do here is to try to ascertain the size of the problem. Obviously, several countries, several organizations, several entities are involved in this conflict. Everybody has a different opinion as to what is the most effective way to resolve this conflict. I think kind of what we would like to do, I think, at this stage is just to focus on the plight of the people and address that, as opposed to address political issues that have much larger geostrategic implications. Right. So with that, I'll take a different. Yes.
So naturally, because of the violence, there is a lot of exploitation of women, of children. There are cases of women who were forced into prostitution to provide for their family and that kind of thing. Is there a body of criminal laws or a prosecutorial authority that can go after these things and investigate it and make sure that there is an end to it? That's in terms of like the physical criminal aspect to it. But there's also the financial part. I mean, you mentioned documentation that costs $600 and $200, and we're talking about people who don't have anything, and these are government officials that are just blatantly taking advantage of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know, is there like an international body or something that exists to take care of that?
Actually, when I was working on GBV, the gender and sex-based violence, we met with women who are informed about what rape incident that happened to them in the host community. But we as an organization, we cannot give those information to the government or to any formal institution unless there is a wish or willing from the survivor to expose those information. But what actually they witness, even if she wants to do that, as I mentioned, the limited legal status that they are in, that they don't have documents or they don't have their residency is not valid, or they crossed the border illegally, then they will be afraid to go and report those issues, because then they themselves will be detained and maybe deported because of their illegal state. So as I mentioned, their access to justice is actually in question here. So it's very limited. And sometimes also the mentality of the police officers that are looking into those facts would also like discriminate against those women, especially if the perpetrator is one of the host community. So it's not easy to achieve justice in those kind of cases.
We'll take one more because we do have to vacate the room at once. So. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
My question is kind of twofold. Do the Syrians who have fled to Lebanon, Jordan, anywhere, is it their intention at this point to return to Syria at some point, or do they usually see it as so far gone because of the bombing that's been going on, the constant civil war that's been going on? And second to that, should they return right now, 6 months from now, while the war is still going on, do they risk persecution by Assad's regime or even the FSA while they're there?
They're returning now. We have like a huge number of people who are returning from Zaatari to Syria on a daily basis. But whether they should stay or not, it's like international obligation to stay. So they have the right to stay in Jordan, but they are returning.
They are
returning, and UNHCR, OCHA, UNICEF, they are trying to figure out where they are returning, to where, what are the reasons behind their decisions, whether they will try to flee back again or not, and who is pushing them to return back to Syria. So it seems that we have like 17 cities in Daraa in the south. They call it freedom. They were freed, under the FSA, Free Syrian Army control. This is what we know.
What has been the reason for returning?
The reason they are not happy at Zaatari.
The
economic situation in Jordan is really different than in Syria. So yesterday I was talking to Dima and I was expressing to her that when Syrians fled to Jordan at the beginning, they said, you don't have water, you don't have like natural resources, prices are so high compared to Syria, we are not happy here and we want to return back to Syria. And this is what is happening. So unfortunately, Jordan, for example, has no natural resources.
Yeah,
and they did not get used to it.
And don't forget that their freedom of movement is restricted.
Yeah.
They are basically detained on this camp.
And they don't have work permit, they can't work, and even if they want to work, the salaries are so low. People get used to their situation. So different reasons.
Yeah, same in Lebanon. Some families are actually choosing to return back to Syria, even though the situation is very bad and they are actually putting themselves at risk. But because of the situation that is very bad as well, that they are living in the host country, so they found themselves obliged to do that, or they will face like extreme poverty and like hunger. So they choose to go back to their relatives or something and like live under danger.
But they're not persecuted when they get back to Syria by Assad's regime?
They might be, of course. They might be. They might be targeted. And yeah, I don't have like information about special cases, but many of them fled because of this persecution. So if they return back, of course, they will face the same kind of persecution.
And on that, let me again thank everybody for coming. Thank you for our panelists.
Thank you for coming. Thanks to Sam Miller for helping to advertise with putting our great flyer together, and to everyone for being here. We appreciate it, and most of all,
thank
for
you.
All of you for taking your time to be with us. Thank you.